Vijay. And today I'll be talking to you, or hopefully convincing you, that when we try to apply machine learning to solving problems, that we should really be thinking about designing search spaces over solutions to those problems. And then we can use automated machine learning techniques in order to evaluate our ideas much more efficiently. I think a big reason why a lot of us are here today is due to the incredible impact that machine learning can have on practical problems. Two often cited reasons for this is that we have increasing amounts of compute capability and access to data to train on. But I think one other aspect is all of you, right? There are so many more people involved in machine learning today that are contributing and publishing ideas. So this graph tries to put this into perspective by measuring how many machine learning papers are published on archive every year since 2009, and plotting that against a Moore's Law exponential growth curve. And as you can see here, we've been keeping up with Moore's Law 2x every 2 years very, very well. And this is demonstrating just how many new ideas are being developed in the field. And this is a great thing, right? So one concrete way of looking at this is that in the field of computer vision, we've seen top one ImageNet accuracy start from something like in the 50% range from the AlexNet architecture, which, by the way, revolutionized the field of image classification. And every year, we've been just getting better and better up until through 2017. Now, these improvements haven't come just because we've been training bigger models, right? These improvements have also come from the fact that we have lots of great ideas, right? Things like batch normalization, residual or skip connections, and various regularization techniques. Now, each of these points, like Jeff mentioned earlier, is the result of years of research effort, and we build on each other's ideas. But one of the challenging things is how do we keep up with so many ideas that are being produced? And I also want to zoom in a little bit in terms of the complexity of some of these models. So we're going to zoom in a little bit on Inception V4 here and look at the kind of idea that's embedded inside there. These are two convolutional cell models or modules within the Inception V4 architecture. Every single one of these arrows and operations and even the numbers was designed by a human, right? Somebody wrote some code in order to specify all of these little details. Now, there are high-level reasons why this kind of architecture might make sense, but our theory doesn't really explain with so much certainty how every detail seems to matter. And as a field, I think we're definitely working on trying to improve the theory behind this. But for many of us, we're just happy to use this kind of complexity out of the box if we can, because it really helps to solve problems. Now, this isn't too surprising. We know that because machine learning has had such an impact on real products that we're going to be willing to use anything we possibly can, and even if we don't understand all the little minor details, as long as it solves our problems well and hopefully are understandable. So given all these ideas, how can we harness this explosion of ideas much more efficiently? So let's step back and kind of ask a few questions that we might have heard when we were just trying to train machine learning models. And these are simple questions, but hard questions. Like, what learning rate should I apply for my optimization? Or if I'm training a deep neural network model, what dropout rate should I apply? How do we answer this question today? I think we combine a few different types of benefits. One of them is leveraging researcher intuition and engineering intuition. And what this means is that we start with code, or we ask our colleagues, hey, what are good settings for these fields? And if it were the case that there was one setting that worked for everybody, we wouldn't even be looking at these parameters. But it does matter, so then we move on to some trial and error process. We try a certain setting, and then we see how well it works on our problem, and then we continue to iterate. And I think the other aspect, which is becoming more common, hopefully, is increasing access to compute and data by which we can evaluate these ideas. So this combination is really ripe for automation, right? And not surprisingly, this exists today. It's called hyperparameter optimization. And in this kind of setup, what we have is a tuner that's giving out settings for these hyperparameter settings. We have a trainer that trains our model on our data set and then tries to give some kind of signal about how good those settings were. And so it might give a validation accuracy of some value. And the tuner can then learn from this feedback to find better points from the search space. And you know, this is an existing big field, and there are existing systems like those shown at the very bottom that can help you to do this. But now let's kind of ask a few more complicated questions or detailed questions that I think people do often ask as well. Why do you use batch norm before ReLU? I switched the order and it seems to work better. Or if you're trying to train a completely new model, should I use one type of subarchitecture or another type of subarchitecture? Now, if you think about it, these questions aren't really that different from hyperparameter settings. So if we think of hyperparameter optimization as searching over a specific domain of ideas, then it seems possible that maybe we can actually treat the decisions made in this type of model as another form of searching over a domain of ideas. And we can therefore think about de-emphasizing any specific decision that we make in our architectures, and instead think about the search space of ideas that we might have. So let's take a concrete example of a search space design that my colleague Barrett did, where he tried to design a search space for a convolutional cell. And I'll walk you through how you might design such a search space. So the first question is, you have to get your inputs. So we might say you have access to your previous input, and if you want to have support for things like skip connections, you might have the previous input. So your first job in the search space is to define which inputs I'm going to select. And then once you have those inputs selected, you want to then figure out what operation should I apply to each of those inputs before summing them together. So I might select something like 3x3 convolution or 3x3 max pooling, and then combine those operations together. Now, we can now then recursively turn that crank and apply it several more times, where we use maybe different operations for different inputs. And we can even use the intermediate outputs of previous decisions in our search. And then finally, you take all of your outputs that are unused, and you concatenate them together. And that is your convolutional cell. And then finally, if you want to build your whole model, just like ResNet, you might stack that same model several times. Now, I want to point out that this is just one example, like one point from the search space of ideas. There are a billion possible ways that you can construct a cell like this in this search space by changing the set of operations you have in your list, the kind of ways that the connections can be made, and so forth. So now we've defined that our search space, we kind of go back to that hyperparameter tuning type system where we have a program generator on the left that generates samples from this search space. We then train and evaluate on the task at hand, and oftentimes it's going to be a proxy task. And then we iterate to quickly find what are the best programs from our search space. And the system on the left, this program generator, can optionally learn from feedback. So it might use something like reinforcement learning, evolutionary algorithms, or even random search can work well in certain situations. So we did this type of approach. We took this convolutional cell, we trained it on a proxy task such as CIFAR-10 for a small number of epochs to make quick progress on the evaluation of an idea. And then we took the best candidate cells that we found from that search. We enlarged in terms of number of filters and number of times we stacked it, and we applied that to the ImageNet data set. And these are two cells found from that search. And if you then look at the results of applying those, you'll see that we were actually able to do better than the existing state-of-the-art models in terms of top one accuracy. Now, this effort was an example where we took a model where decisions were pretty complex, and we honestly found another complex model that was better. But next, I'll show you an example where we can use this general technique to find even more interpretable outputs. So let's look at optimization update rules. Most of you are probably familiar with stochastic gradient descent, and the update rule is shown on the left, where you take the gradient and you multiply it by the learning rate, and that's your weight delta. And then we have more advanced optimization update rules, like ADAM. And these can be expressed fairly concisely, just by being given things like the moving average of the gradient and so forth. But we really only have like a handful of these type of optimization update rules that we typically apply for deep learning, for example. What if we instead treat these update equation rules as parts of a larger search space? And so you can take these expressions and turn them into a kind of a data flow graph that describes the update rule. And by using a small set of primitive operations and ways of combining them, we can express these two update rules using this simple tree, but also a lot of other ideas. And so you can then turn this crank on this new search space and try to find a better optimization update rule. So my colleagues Erwin and Barrett ran this experiment where they took a fixed convolutional model and tried to search over the optimization rules. And they found update equations that did better than some of the others I had shown you on this particular task. And one nice feature of this search space is that the results are much more interpretable. If you look at the fourth update rule here, it's taking the gradient and multiplying it by some expression that essentially says that when the gradient and the moving average of the gradient agree in their direction, then we should take a bigger step in that direction. And when they disagree, that we should take a smaller step. This is actually a form of momentum. And so one thing we can get from this is maybe we should be designing search spaces that have more notions of momentum encoded within the search space of ideas. We may be able to find even better results. So far, I've focused on techniques and search space ideas where we care about accuracy. But what's great about searching over many ideas is that we might have the potential to search over more than just accuracy. So, for example, a lot of us care about inference speed, right? We want to take a model and deploy it on real hardware, real mobile platform. And very often, we spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to take one idea and make it fast enough. But what if you could, you know, as part of the search space of ideas, find ones that balance both speed and accuracy? So we tried to do this experiment where we included the runtime on a real mobile device as part of this inner loop of the evaluation. So we tried to focus to optimize on both accuracy as well as inference speed. And as this process goes on over time, the program generator is able to find faster models while also figuring out how to make those models even more accurate. One interesting side effect of this is that when you run searches over ideas, the output is actually not just one model, it's a culture of models that implicitly encodes this trade-off. So this kind of shows you that we have points along the space that provide a trade-off between inference speed on a mobile platform and accuracy on the data set that we're trying to solve. And so rather than manually engineering the one point that I really want to get working, I can get a result that maybe can be deployed on various types of platforms. So I'll emphasize this in maybe a slightly different way, which is that we could define a search space of ideas in TensorFlow, and through this automatic machine learning process, we can get models that have a guaranteed runtime performance target on a target platform device. And one of the nice things about having an integrated ecosystem like TensorFlow is that you can just use the libraries that convert from program to program so that you can get this end-to-end pipeline working well together. There's no manual work required to specifically tune a model. So let me conclude by returning to this process of evaluating ideas in this world where we're trying to explore different ideas. The first is that we design search spaces to try to test out a large set of possible ideas. Now note that when we design the search space, that required human intuition, right? There's still a need for human ingenuity as part of this process. So designing the search space properly takes a lot of effort, but at least it allows you to evaluate many more ideas much more quickly. And when it comes to trial and error, we had to start thinking about how software should be changed so that we can permit this type of search process. So for example, I think many of us have probably written scripts where you take things like learning rate and dropout rate as command line flags. What if you wanted to test out much more deeper ideas in your programs? How do you design it such that it's much more tunable at all levels of your program? I think this is a big question for us to tackle. And lastly, we think these ideas will become increasingly relevant as many of you get access to more and more computation capabilities, such as things like TPU pods. Imagine a world where all you have to do is take your idea, submit it to an idea bank, and you have some like pod of TPUs crunching overnight, trying to figure out which solutions or ideas are the best, and then waking up in the morning and it telling you, these were the good ideas, these were the bad ideas, and so forth. I think part of the reason this excites me is that automatic machine learning can keep these machines much more busy than we can. We have to sleep, but machines can keep on churning 24/7. So with that, thanks for listening.